In this tutorial, I'll be going over how to create a raycast weapon using Godot, as well as how to add a simple crosshair and recoil system. Lastly, we'll be implementing satisfying bullet hit effects that change direction based on collision. Hope you enjoy. Let's start in our player scene, which I've already set up with the basics of a 3D character. First, in our camera node, we'll need to add a gun. For this tutorial, I'll be using a model that I made in Blender. Now that our gun's in position, let's add a raycast node as a child of our camera. First, we'll need to rotate our raycast to be facing forwards. Next, we'll need to set our target position, which will determine the range of our raycast. Now, after adding a script to our player, I'm going to replace the base movement code with my own. The functionality of this is the same, except for this code block here, which will receive input from our mouse, as well as allowing the player to look around by rotating our spatial node, which I renamed head. Now that we have our player set up, let's get started on raycasting. Let's continue in our player script. In here, I'm first going to create a damage variable. This will determine how much damage our raycast will do. Next, I'll connect the raycast node to the script using an onReady variable. Now in our physics process function, we can start setting up our shooting code. First, we'll need to add an input for player shooting, which can be done in our project settings. Now, if we push our shoot button, we'll call our shoot function, which basically represents our bullet. Now in our shoot function, we'll use the isColliding function to check if the raycast is colliding with something. Next, I'm going to create a few variables. One that will find the collision point of our raycast, another that will find the normal of our collision, and a target variable that returns an object that our raycast collided with. Now if the target is not equal to null, in another if statement, we'll use the isInGroup function to check if the target is in the enemy group, and the hasMethod function to check if it has the enemy hit method. If so, we'll need to call the enemy hit method. Remember to pass in the damage variable to this method. I know this might be a bit confusing, but it'll make sense in about 30 seconds. Now that our raycast code is set up, let's go to our enemy scene. As with the player, this is already set up with a kinematic body and collision node as a child. In the shape menu, I'll add a capsule shape that extends around the mesh. Before we get to coding, we'll need to add a group to the enemy. In node, select group and add the group name, which was enemy with a capital E. What this does is help the raycast determine if it is colliding with an enemy or not. Now with that set up, let's add a script to our enemy. First, we're going to need to make a health variable. I'm going to set the max health to 15. Now let's add our enemy hit method. Remember to pass in the damage variable that we created in our player. When the function is called, we'll have the enemy health decrease by the amount in our damage variable. Then, if the enemy health is equal to 0, it will be removed from the scene. Because I'm going to be creating an automatic weapon, we're going to want to limit the fire rate to some degree. To do this, we'll need to add a timer node to our player, which I'll call fire rate. Now in the timer node, select one shot and lower the wait time to be the desired fire rate of your weapon. Now we'll need to add a timeout signal to our player script. We're going to pass on this for now. In the meantime, let's create a can't shoot boolean variable, which will be true by default. This will determine whether or not our player can shoot. Now, in the timeout signal, we'll set the can't shoot variable to true when the timer goes off. Next, in our physics process function, when we shoot, we'll also want to check if can't shoot is true. Then, if it is, we're going to set can't shoot to false and start the fire rate timer. Now when we hold the shoot button, if our raycast is colliding with the enemy, they'll die. This is great, but we can't really see where we're aiming. We can fix this by adding a crosshair to our player. First, let's add a control node. This will act as a container for our other nodes. Remember to select full rect so that this extends across the entire window. Now let's add another control node, which we'll use to center the crosshair on our screen. Before centering the node, remember to shrink the border all the way down. Now that our control nodes are added, we'll create a line 2D node. This will be the center of our crosshair. In the paths drop-down menu, I'm going to increase this size to 2. Now, on the x-axis, I'll slightly increase the line's length. Next, I'll want to decrease the width of our line. Finally, in the capping drop-down menu, I'm going to round both the edges. This will cause our line to look more like a circle. With the center done, let's start making the sides. Like before, let's create another line 2D node. Next, I'll change the points, length, and width of the line to fit the size that I want. Remember that we'll need to duplicate this 3 times to account for each side. Now, we're going to rotate each side to account for both the X and Y axes. Finally, I'm going to move these into position, which will be 10 on the X axis, 10 on the Y axis, negative 10 on the X axis, and negative 10 on the Y axis respectively. Remember these positions, we'll be using them later. Before we start coding, inside of our first control node, Click on the mouse drop-down menu. In Filter, select Pass. This will allow our game to capture the input from our mouse. Now, we can add a script to our crosshair node. In here, using an onReady variable, I'm going to make a reference to the right crosshair point. I'm also going to reference the bottom, left, and top points as well. Next, we're going to need to make two variables, one that will control the final position of our crosshair, which I'll call growPosition, and another that will control the speed of growth, which I'll call growSpeed. Next, let's create a physics process function. In here, if the player is holding the shoot button, we're going to set the position of our right crosshair point equal to our lerp function. First, we'll set up our starting point, which is the right point's original position. Then, we'll set this to move to the growPosition on the x-axis. Finally, we'll want to take into account our growSpeed variable. Remember that we'll also need to do this for the y, negative x, and negative y axes as well. Now, if we're not shooting, we can reset the crosshair position to where it was originally. We can do this by copying and pasting the above code and replacing our growPosition variable with 10, which is where our crosshair points were before shooting. Nice. As you can see, when we shoot, our crosshair will grow, and if not, it'll shrink. In games, there are many different kinds of recoil. In this tutorial, I'll be focusing on combining both random spread and camera movement. First, let's add a script to the camera. This is where we're going to code our recoil. First, I'll create two Vector3 variables, final and target position. These will determine the position of the camera. Next, I'll create three variables, max recoil, which determines the final position of the camera, recoil speed, which will be the speed of the camera's rotation, and return speed, which is how fast the camera will return. Finally, we'll need to connect our raycast node to the script using an onReady variable. Next, let's create a physics process function. We're going to set the final position equal to our lerp function. In here, we'll set the final position as the origin point, then vector3.0 as the target. Finally, we'll need to take the return speed into account. What this will do is constantly interpolate the camera back to its original position. Next, let's rotate the camera. First, we'll set the current position equal to a lerp function with our current position as the origin, the target position as the target, and finally, pass in our recoil speed. The final thing we'll need to do is make the camera's rotation degrees equal to the current rotation. Next, if the player presses the shoot function, we'll call our apply recoil function. This is where we're going to cause our recoil. In here, I'm first going to make a variable that randomizes the position of our raycast, which I'll call spread. Next, I'll add another variable, called random spread. We'll set this equal to a vector3. Now, in a random range function, we'll randomize the spread variable on both the negative and positive x and y axes. Lastly, we're going to set our raycast position equal to our random spread variable. Finally, we'll set the final position's x-axis equal to our max recoil variable, which limits the camera's rotation. Nice, now as we shoot our gun, our camera will rotate upwards and the raycast location will be randomized. This looks pretty good, but we can add much more detail. Finally, let's start making our effects. First, let's add a spatial node to a new scene. I'll call this bullet decal. Next, let's add a mesh instance to the scene. In the mesh drop-down menu, I'm going to add a quad mesh. Now, in material, we'll add a new standard material. In the albedo drop-down menu, I'm going to drag and drop our bullet hole image into our texture menu. Next, in the transparency menu, we'll add the depth pre-pass transparency. Now, in the transform menu, we'll need to rotate the mesh 180 degrees, and bring the mesh upward slightly on the z-axis, which prevents the bullet hole from clipping into objects. Now, let's create another scene with a GPU particles node as the parent. I'll rename this terrain particles. Now let's start setting this up. In draw pass, select pass 1. In the drop-down menu, I'll add a cube mesh. Now, in material, add a new particle material. In albedo, I'm going to change the base color of the mesh to be light gray. Next, in process material, we're going to add a new particle material. In here, I'll first change the emission shape to a sphere with a small radius. Now in the directed menu, I'm going to set the particles to be emitting on the negative z-axis. I'm also going to lower the spread. Then, in gravity, I'll set this as 2.5 on the negative y-axis. Next, in the initial velocity menu, I'm going to apply the minimum and maximum velocity. Finally, in scale, I'll add a maximum and minimum scale so that each particle will be a different size. Finally, in the time drop-down menu, I'm going to decrease the lifetime. Next, I'll increase the speed scale so that the particles emit quickly, and add some explosiveness so that all the particles will be emitted at the same time. Before we start coding, I'm going to add a bit more particles and select one shot. This ensures our particles only emit once. Now let's add a script to the scene. First, I'm going to create a ready function. In here, I'm going to set the particles to be emitting by default. Next, in a physics function, if the particles are not emitting, we'll delete them from the scene. Now that our terrain particles are done, we can start setting up our enemies. In project, select new inherited scene to create a copy of this scene. Now I'll rename this to be enemy particles. Next, we're going to need to make this scene editable. To do this, click on the properties menu and select make sub-resources unique. Now we can edit this scene. I'm going to keep this scene mostly the same, save for the amount of particles being emitted, the initial velocity, and the shape and color of the particles. Phew, finally, we're almost done. Let's go into our player script. In here, I'm first going to preload our bullet decal, terrain, and enemy particles scene. Next, in our shoot function, if our target is in the enemy group and has the enemy hit method, we're going to create a variable that instances our enemy particle scene. Next, we'll want to have the enemy particles be emitting at the collision point of our raycast. Finally, we're going to add the enemy particles to the current scene. Next, we're going to set the enemy particles emission direction. To do this, we'll use a lookit function on the enemy particles. Then, in here, we're going to add the collision point and normal together. Finally, we'll use a vector3.up method to align the particles with the y-axis. We're going to copy this code. However, instead of using the vector3.up method, we're going to use write instead. This will align the particles with the x-axis so that they will emit upwards when hitting the floor. Now, let's start working on instancing our other particles. This is similar to our above code. First, we'll check if our target is not in the enemy group or enemy hit method. Then, we'll instance both the terrain particles and bullet decals. Great. Now when we shoot our enemies, blood particles will be spawned. Then, if we shoot anything else, our bullet decal and terrain particles will spawn. We can also see that, depending on the surface direction of our objects, the decal and particle emission direction will be changed to emit away from the object. Phew, after all that work, we're finally done. As you can see, everything is working pretty well together. I hope that this tutorial was helpful. If you have any questions, feel free to comment. Also, don't forget to like and subscribe if you'd like to see more content like this. See you in the next video.